I welcome you to Chiral Ventures Inspire with Chiral series, and we are very grateful that an eminent personality such as you has joined us for this interaction. Ma'am, the first question for you is, what is your background basically, and how were you inspired to get into academics, and what was the thinking behind becoming a doctor or getting a doctorate and all that?
The thing is, I come from a very middle-class Parsi family. And it has always been inculcated right from my childhood that we have to think for ourselves. We have to have, and we used to have all the freedom to think for ourselves, to explore all different types of knowledges, to read whatever books that you want. And that is what brought out the vision and brought out the depth of my thinking. Once that started, it inculcated in me the love for reading. And once it went into that, in my school days, we used to run to the library. Now, this is something which I don't do with my students at all. Nobody runs to the library. We used to have a short recess and a long recess, and we used to run over there many a times, eat food in 5 minutes and go over there so that we could get the best of the Amar Chitra Kathas that used to come out for reading, and we used to start reading. This gave us the ability to make language, to have a good language command, to understand the spellings, and not just over here English. I would also read in Hindi, which was a language over here, which was taught over there. My only grievance is that I did in Marathi. If I did that, maybe I would have got my Marathi language also in my command. So this love for my teaching started coming up, because as you read, you understand the knowledge, the language, the subject, and that gave us that. I always knew that I would become a teacher. Once I became that, you know, my teaching career started in my alma mater college, that is KC College. Over there, I asked my professors that would you give me the ability to know what my teaching capabilities are by giving me a chance to teach in your class. And Dr. Korea, who was the head of that department, she said, why not, Zareen, why don't you join in? I will sit at the back and you teach. We'll find out whether you are a good teacher or here a poor teacher. And that was when I was in my master's class. So with that, she gave me the stamp that you are a probably a good teacher. You can go ahead. And that's how I started with. I always wanted to join an institute which has moral values. And in that way, I was very lucky that I was able to be picked up here by Bhavan's College, which believes in Gandhian values and principles. And that's how the teaching started. And once I joined there, I have enjoyed my career tremendously over a period of time. And, you know, we remain a teacher. I became a researcher. We are entrepreneurs because we have started the Bhavan's Research Center, which is an entrepreneur with industries. And with that came the idea of becoming an administrator. And now I'm in the administration field over here of that. That's my small
matter. Okay. So, could you just lower your screen because I'm not able to see.
Sorry. This is my movable camera, na? So therefore, it just goes on moving up and down. I think I'll have to catch it like this. Okay, fine. Fine. Oh dear. Sorry. Okay. Tell me.
So, ma'am, we are Bhavan's College alumni, and we graduated in BMM. And during those times, we had a project in each subject. And what we used to do is, we used to Google the whole project. And then just 10% was our presentation.
That's so
we are very embarrassed to say that, but that was the truth. But we have read that you are guiding PhD students in their life.
Yes.
What is your process? How do you guide them, basically?
See, research has always been the hallmark of my career, and I am a better researcher than a good teacher. And what I normally feel is that when we take a student, I select a student based on the capability of hard work. Okay. And a good thinking process. Okay, so if there is hard work, then automatically the student starts by to think well, because he knows that I'm putting in so much of effort. Why am I doing it? What is the need for it? So therefore, you must have that drive to go ahead with it. I normally, my style of research is that I guide them for writing their proposals. Okay, and giving them the ideas, giving them thoughts over here as such, and then leave the freedom to them. Okay, I just go ahead, do whatever you feel the need for that you require, what type of a project you want to go about, what type of a thought. But once they come back, I normally sit with them and discuss this thing with it to understand what their thought process is, how they are thinking, whether they have skill or that drive to go to the depth of it, and whether it has got relevance in that of the field. That is my job. Okay. Once that is done, I say, okay, fine. This is the topic which would interest both of us. Go ahead. You write on it. And I normally see to it that the proposal is complete in all aspects, in terms of how they would like to go about their methodology, their conclusion types that they would try to draw about. All those things are very clearly defined out in that proposal. And then I leave them to do the bench work. I do not interfere. I said, now you start with this. This is written down. Now you make your mistakes and learn from that mistake. So they go on doing that, and then they come out with the results, and I then grill them on the results, whether these results are valid, whether these results are not valid, whether they are concoct, whether they are, just made up. Right. All those things are checked out. And if it comes proper, then I tell them whether to repeat it, whether not to repeat it, and then go ahead by here with the next experiment as such. Okay. So therefore, this is how I normally go about with that of my research work. And in most of the times that I would like to say is that my research has been, I would not say completely pioneered, but research which has been granted. That means that it has been funded. It has been funded by DST. It has been funded by DBT. I've got a crore or so grants that have come from different types of projects. Now, with such types of projects which are going on, nobody will fund it until and unless they find application. And that is what I want the research in India to be. Because they consider research is not just researching. It is also means where you're researching something new. The same thing going round and round does not have any meaning. So you stand on the path that your forefathers have made. But at the same time, you go ahead to something new. And therefore, we must have original ideas. And that is what India is lacking tremendously in that part of it. So therefore, when they say that you do 90% Google, I am not for it at all. And let me tell you this part also, that Bhavans College has got autonomy. And as it has started with this autonomy process, we are going to have a very stringent evaluation system. And the projects will have their rubrics, and one of the rubrics will be not Googled aspect. It should be something original. You have material from Google. It's not that it is not there, but I don't believe in plagiarism. I don't believe in taking things and just cut pasting it. So all those things will be checked out over here, and then only the projects will be evaluated. So this is my small bit in making the people understand what proposals and researches mean.
Of course. Ma'am. So all of this brings us to our next question, that researching in India and researching abroad, like we always hear that researching in US or UK or Europe is always better than researching in India. So do you agree with that, or what are the measures that you have implemented that?
During our project works, I have gone to Korea because they were my partners. Just now, last October, we went to Vienna where to present the project along with my students. And we have also presented one of the posters in London. So we have gone to institutes and we have seen that at the institute. What I find missing in India is the fact that, you know, the drive is missing, in especially in higher institutes. We go on doing the same thing again and again, where we don't think ahead. There is no discussion going on. There is no, openness which is there in our research here, because they try to remain in localized in one, small community or some pond, and they go on seeing that. What I saw abroad was the fact that people sit, at any time of that of the day or night to do their work. In Korea, we were saying in the campus, and you'll be surprised to see that if I open up my curtains at 4 o'clock in the night, the building is lit and everybody is working. I said, my goodness, they are working at 4 o'clock. If you see them in the morning, again, where they are working, there is a bed in their rooms, in the labs, for somebody to know, yeah, there is breakfast which is put up. So they are working day and night, where that drive is missing out in, we have good minds, but I think right. The drive is missing.
Right.
So that's, if that comes out now and people can get, enthused about their research work, then I think we will be in a position of, importance.
Right. Ma'am, our next question is that, we have read that you have won the Ideal Teacher or Ideal Principal Award from Mumbai University.
Yes.
So,
ma'am, Best Teacher's Award.
So, ma'am, according to you, what are the attributes of an ideal teacher?
I don't think there are something great about this award. It is just that it is an award which has been given for the achievements that have been done over the past 35 years. Mm-hmm. And I'm grateful for that award, definitely from Mumbai University. But the attributes, I would say, is just the same. Hard work, nothing more. And having a love for the subject and being kind to the students. Understanding the students, understanding their problems, giving them solutions to that of these problems. And, being with them as a friend, as a motivator, as for to inspire them a little, and at the same time correct them, because I'm a taskmaster. I do not normally leave things. They will give lots of reasons, but I know how to know whether those reasons are right or wrong. And if they are right, accept them. If they are wrong, go here, tell them that this is not the way it will work out. Let's go ahead with something more better, and things work out. I think that's it. Basically, what you do at home with your children, the same thing you do with that of the children in the college. It's enough. It's enough. More than enough. Go here as such to become a beloved teacher.
Right, ma'am. Actually, we have heard that during school time, the teachers were like our parents only. But when we entered college, then the teachers' thinking was a little different. But we are glad that you have said that you are just like a parent to them. That is a very good thing.
Yes.
Ma'am, our next question is, as you transition from being a teacher to being a principal of a college, so what are the different things that you experience, or what are your differences in approach?
Oh my, how much difference it has become. Those last 2 years have been so different from my last 35 years, where I miss my teaching. The first thing that I find is that my lecture loads have become less, and I miss my teaching and interaction with my students, because the administrative load is so much. You require to have a lot of patience to get the work done. And at the same time, what would I say, that, it is grueling. It's a grueling task where you have to take a large college, 9,000 plus students, to see their problems. Not just the students and tackle their problems, but to tackle the problems of the teachers, to tackle the problems of the non-teaching staff, where the temporary staff, where to see about the infrastructure, to see about where quality, to see about so many different aspects. So it's a big, big task to take, and it's very different from what we used to teach. Teaching means you teach a small number of students, and those are your major. Now this is a big forum to go ahead with, and there are different problems. Problems which are sometimes very minute but accelerate into a large issue, and sometimes where they are so small that they can just be tackled in one instance and finished off. But we are supposed to be having loads of patience and loads of commitment to that of the job. That's what you require when you become into that. The chair is a bed of thorns, and you of have course, to literally sit on it every day 24/7 and still smile over it. That's what it is. But it is, it's a fitting end to a career wherein you have given 35 to 37 years of your life, which has groomed you, which has made you what you are. And I feel that that's a small way in which I can give to Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan's College of Health. So that's my respect to that of my
your contribution.
Company who has made my life over here in this planet.
Okay,
I have one motto I would say as a principle, which I would just like over here you to know, which I have kept it in my mind. I work in such a way that I motivate the weak, I address the average, and I challenge the gifted. This is what my whole, the way in which I work. I see to it that the gifted are challenged sufficiently. I see to it that the average people are also addressed in there, and they do not get lost in the whole crowd. And the weak, I see to it that I motivate them to go ahead again in their life. This is what my role as a principal is.
Right. You have already answered my next question. That I was going to ask you, what is your leadership style, or how do you motivate?
This is my leadership style. This is what I. This is my underlining principle on which I work. And that is the principle that I've put up even in my address in the websites of Bhavan's College. I see to it that this is the principle by which I try to go on working.
Right. Coming to current times, we are already facing the lockdowns and economic slowdown for COVID-19 era. So what would be your message to current students or the students who are entering graduation or postgraduate students? So what would be their mindset like to face the current situation?
See, this is a transient solution, a transient problem. This problem will go. I'm not belittling the problem. The problem is definitely there. There are lots of people who are affected. Now itself, I'm in quarantine because my next door neighbor has got COVID-19. So therefore, I'm in quarantine, and it will finish maybe in 1 or 2 days, hopefully. But what I would say is that this should not stop your life. I would say, we will persist. That's what we will come back. And that's what it is going to be. So just now we have got few problems. We go online, we do Zoom meetings, we have lectures like this. We are not able to interact. But we will come back to that of the college, and we will take lectures, and we will interact personally with each other, and we will again become a Bhavan's family once more. So I would tell my students that please, have resilience, go ahead, with whatever you were doing, in the best way that you can. Do not stop learning. Do not stop learning, because that's the way it has to go ahead. Go on studying. Do not stop the process of gaining education, because that is what is going to fetch you a better prospect in that of your life. So therefore, just take it in your stride in the best way that you can. And, the times will pass by and you will again prevail.
Okay. Okay, thank you, ma'am. Today the time was short, so the interaction is this much only. But we are very grateful.
It's a, It's a pleasure and ma'am, to be here.
And ma'am, we'll upload this on YouTube, and when we get some comments or we get some questions, we'll definitely get one more interaction.
I'll definitely be there over here to talk to you all as such, because this is a very good forum by which I can interact with my students also. And I'll always tell my students that my doors of the principal's office was always open over here. I never close the door. It is always open unless there is some emergency or some type of risk or security. That way I close the door. So therefore, it's always open. Please do come up. But also at the same time, I would also request that keep the decorum also. Otherwise, everybody comes up. I'm only one person with two hands over here to work with. So therefore, maintain the decorum so that we are able to work with the best of that ability.
Yes, ma'am. So from Chiral Ventures side, we thank you. And we'll definitely do a one-to-one interview when the lockdown and COVID passes.
Yes, definitely. Definitely. We'll talk about education over here in much more detail.
Yes, of course.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. So we'll end this interview.
Okay. Yes, thank you. Bye-bye. I'll take your leave.
Yes, ma'am. Bye.